It's a magical kingdom in a mixed up world. You're in the sweet spot, baby. You're in the sweet spot, girl. You're in the sweet spot, darling. It's a magical kingdom in a mixed up world.
Welcome to the Sweep Spot Podcast. My name is Lynn, your host, and Ken's my co-host. Ken, how's it going?
Oh, it is going, it is going. I'm so happy to be here, Lynn.
Yes, this is episode 350.
350, Lynn! That is amazing. I can't believe that.
It is.
350. We've got to do a giveaway or something. Something. I don't know.
Well, we have a great guest tonight for our 350, so I'm really excited
about
that.
That's true. That's true.
Ken and I are both former Disneyland Custodial cast members, and we host the number one Disneyland Custodial or Disneyland podcast hosted by two Disneyland Custodial cast members.
Number one.
Yay. We're also authors of the books Queen of the Kingdom. You get those on our website, signed, both volumes, and we have them in audio if you want to get the USB drives specially designed, and those will be signed also. So check those out on our website while supplies last.
Yes.
We're also, if you want to help support us and the support the show and the expenses that go into it, it's not, be a part of what we're doing, you could join our Patreon. And you can do that by going to our website, thesweepspot.com, or search at Patreon's website, The Sweep Spot. And with that, you get one bonus episode per month delivered to you. And you also get to participate in one of our current events per month, where you get to join in the chat and participate in the episode by leaving comments, and we'll try to interact with your comments. And it's a lot of fun. So you get all that for $5 or more a month by joining our Patreon. Speaking of that, we have one new Patreon I wanted to mention.
All right.
And his name is Ed Engler.
Oh, thank you, Ed.
Yes, thank you so much, Ed. We appreciate it. Hope to see you at our next current events that will be later this month. I think on the 20th, actually, of January. Who is our guest tonight?
Well, we have a returning guest. It's Tom Morris. He's a he has worked with Imagineering, Tom is a longtime fan as well.
Yes.
Having gone to Walt Disney World as a kid when it opened, by himself without his parents.
Yeah, I know.
and you know Tom's work, whether or not you are aware that you know Tom's work. So.
Yeah, we had an interview where we talked about Tom and some of his projects and how he got into Imagineering, and that was in June of 2019, and it was episode 262.
Yeah, so if you want to go back in our free archive,
yeah,
to find that, you can go ahead and listen.
Plan your next getaway vacation to a Disney destination by contacting our friends at Concierge, our magical travel and vacation planning partners.
Whether you're going to Walt Disney World, Disneyland, a Disney cruise, Disney's Alani in Hawaii, or Adventures by Disney, contact the people who specialize in Disney. Want to visit Universal? Concierge can help you with that too. It's not going to add any cost to your vacation. Go to concierge.com, that is concierge.com, like concierge and mouse ears, because they are your travel concierge to Disney, with you every step of the way.
They can get you reservations, update you on changes, conditions, and take away the stress of planning a vacation. Let them do the heavy lifting.
I send my own mother to Concierge. We like them so much, Lynn works with them. I wouldn't plan another Disney vacation without going to Concierge.
Mention the Sweep Spot when you book a package with them. like a week on a Disney cruise or a hotel stay with theme park admission tickets, and get a special gift. So I wanted to add this in because this is our 350th show, as we had mentioned in the introduction, but that's not counting the 12 current events that we've done on their own that we started just last year. And I did the mini episodes kind of during the pandemic time, and there was 35 of those. So that puts us at almost 400, and I believe there was a couple other shows that we had done that weren't numbered since then. And so that's about 400 shows, and I just thought, you know what, that is amazing. Not many shows can do that. And the thing that amazes me the most is the people that continue to listen to us. It's just amazing to me. And it's just been so humbling to get to meet so many people over the years and get to know some of our listeners. And, you know, I started this in March of 2011. So it's been almost 12 years. This March it'll be 12 years since we've been doing the sweep spot. I did not start with Ken as my host. I had Laura for a couple years, and that was great. We had a good thing going with that. And then for a couple episodes, I had someone else. Man, I can't think at the moment. And then Ken had always kind of been there in the, he had come as a guest and talked, probably our most frequent guest during those years. And when the time came, you know, I asked Ken if he would want to be a full-time on the show with me. And of course he said yes. I've known Ken since 1998 when I started in custodial. Excuse me. And so we've been friends for a long time. And now to get to do the show with him, we record every other week. Although there's a show released every week, we record every other week. And that's been great too. So I want to thank Ken personally just for putting up with me and just for doing the show, because without the show, you know, I think it sparked my interest in Disney more and made me more curious. As a cast member working there, I enjoyed the history. I had some books and things. But I think what really got me more interested was because of the show and being forced to do, especially the first few years when I did it with Laura, we were doing history shows week after week. And we did have guests then, but we had more shows without guests than we did with guests. And now that's kind of changed because the more people we meet, the more we want to interview them and have them and share their stories on our show. So that's kind of the way things have evolved. And we don't plan on changing anything. I think it's a good formula. I think that it's a good balance. Because I still enjoy doing shows where it's just Ken and I. Because when we have guests, we don't really have a chance to talk a lot. And that's fine. But I do enjoy the shows where we can. So I also want to thank the listeners. You, who's listening. You know, when we do these live events and we go to D23 or Disneyana, and we get to meet some of our listeners, you have no idea how much that means to us. To get to see a face of someone that has listened to our show, and I'm recording in Utah, Ken's in Anaheim, we're just doing this thing on our computers, and to know that it's reaching people all over the world, and then to finally see some of these people face to face is amazing. So I want to thank you. I know this is long-winded, but it's it's important, I think, to recognize. And then to have people like on our Patreon to help support the show, it just blows me away. People that want to be interested and help us. I sometimes feel bad asking for money to help, but at the same time, I also remind myself that we're providing a service, you know, just like people pay for, you know, Netflix or whatever. We're providing entertainment and a service. So I have to remind myself, this does take a lot of work. I spend a lot of time editing and putting time into getting guests and everything. So there's a lot of planning too. But I do really, truly appreciate the people that support us and help with Patreon. It just wows me every time. So I just wanted to have this little message and have it here for you to know that we really do appreciate you. So to start off this year, we're going to have a great guest on, like we had mentioned, and I'm really excited about you listening in on this. And we have some great plans for 2023. Thank you.
In our first television show last year, we described to you our hopes and plans for a place called Disneyland. A few months ago, in a progress report, we showed you the actual start of construction. In our mail recently, a lot of you have shown interest in our progress. And so this week, just a matter of days away from the formal opening of Disneyland, we want to bring you up to date on what's been happening and let you share with us the joys and anxieties of our race against time. In this, our final report on building a Disneyland, I want to pay tribute to the many studio artists, craftsmen, and engineers whose untiring efforts help bring this dream into a reality.
So, Tom, I know that WDI is something that, you know, everyone knows Imagineering, but they don't know WDI and what it is and what it was created for. And I had a question. Was it created for the building of Disneyland?
There's several ways that that can be answered. Mm-hmm. I wish I could give you a direct answer. I think in Walt's mind, it was probably the main reason. I think the main reason for the creation of WED in Walt's mind was to work on projects that he wanted to work on that the studio may not necessarily wanted to get behind. But there is a technical, real reason for the creation of WED, which was after there came a time when Walt needed to renegotiate his contract. And this was that period of time when Walt and Roy were there were some tense relations between the two, you know, during this negotiation process. And that went on for, you know, a few years. Yeah. But ultimately, Roy really did want to take care of his little brother.
Yeah.
And, you know, didn't want his little brother to leave. And also, I mean, he really did care for Walt's family and had learned that several famous creators, if you will, including most notably, which is written about in a couple of biographies, L. Frank Baum, the creator of The Wizard of Oz, somehow ended up losing all of his rights. Or most of the rights to the stories. And I don't know if he died a poor person, but he certainly didn't, get benefit of the riches that he deserved for coming up with those stories. And Walt was concerned about that, and so was Walt's lawyer.
Yeah.
And this was a time when the different motion picture studio moguls were creating their little holding companies, mm-hmm. which is still done today. And what they would do, you know, that's where their royalties and their bonuses and all sorts of things, their shares in particular motion picture projects would go into these holding holding entities.
Right.
And right. what they would do with that to offset the taxes, this is a really boring answer, but this is the real answer.
No, it's good.
This is the real answer for the formation of lead. So these moguls would invest in oil wells and cattle ranches and things like Santa Anita, you know, like racing tracks and things like that. And that way it offset the royalties and that kind of income that had a high tax rate. And so Walt's lawyers, Walt's brother wanted Walt to have a holding, you know, thought Walt should have a holding company for his family to protect his family in case something happened to the company, where his name would still have value, you know, were the company to be taken over, for example, or dissolve. And so, you know, and different entities get rights to different Disney things. The Disney family would still get royalties from that. And so, but rather than going, taking that royalty money and putting it into oil wells and ranches, I mean, can you see Walt Disney, you know, spending his time on that?
No.
He wanted to, you know, take that money and use it for his independent projects. Mm. And so WED was formed at the end of December of 52. And the first project that Walt wanted to tackle, because at the moment, at that moment in time, the studio was not interested in either Disneyland or in television. So Walt wanted to get into television first as a means of providing an income stream for projects like Disneyland. You know, Disneyland was at the top of the list, I'm sure, by that time.
Oh, yeah.
So Walt hired the first Imagineer. His name was Nat Weinkauf. Mm-hmm. And that was also at the end of 1952. And Nat's job was to get the television series Zorro started up.
Oh.
And that was the first WED project.
Wow.
And Nat Weinkauf was selected for that project because he had worked on some TV projects for NBC that were filmed television projects.
Oh, okay.
Filmed television programs. And most, you know, television at that time was not filmed. It was expensive.
Right.
And but he had some experience in that. He was actually, his main order of business during his career was he was a music agent, music producer, things of that nature. He represented a few starlets and various musicians. And but somehow he gotten into TV, and somehow he got he met Walt, and they hired him to put this together, this TV show, because Walt wanted to film it. And that's how it started.
did he go on to help out with Disneyland also?
He did.
Yeah.
He became kind of Walt's business guy, who eventually his main focus on Disneyland was wining and dining the prospective lessees and participants and investors. And doing the presentations and creating the orientations. So he was probably the first person to orient Van France, for example.
Oh, okay.
He was the University of Disneyland, all in one, you know, for the first several months, probably up to the time of opening.
Oh.
And or up at least until he got Van France, you know, started. So and the other kind of business person was Bill Cottrell, who was Walt's brother-in-law and also a story guy, going way back to the Hyperion days. Mm-hmm. And because Bill was part of family, he wanted someone who was part of family kind of to be the president, I guess you would say. And,
yeah.
And but he, in addition to being president, he was also kind of the first nomenclature guy. And because he was a writer and he was kind of a clever writer, and he invented a lot of the terms that, you know, we still use today, allegedly, and I haven't been able to absolutely 100% verify it, but allegedly he came up with the term buffeteria.
Oh.
He came up with a lot of terms like that, like utilidor.
Yes.
And, there were several of those. You probably remember in New Orleans Square that dish conveyor that used to go through New Orleans Square from cafe to cafe. Uh-huh. That was called a dish veyor.
Oh.
Bill Cottrell named that. So Bill was the guy that was going to be the head writer for Zorro, and Nat Wyckoff was going to be the producer. I guess Cottrell was really kind of like the director, creative director in charge. Mm-hmm. And Nat Wyckoff would have been the producer. And so Cottrell hired several writers to write episodes of Zorro, and he had like 18 episodes for it written. And as 1953 progressed, as they got into spring, they were still dealing with Walt still, had the park very much at the forefront of his mind, and but they were still trying to figure out, could they get it to fit across the street? This is when William Pereira and Luckman were working on it. Mm-hmm. And so concurrent with and Pereira, they were saying, this site that's across from the studio is way too small. I mean, you don't even have enough room for parking, let alone for the park.
Yeah.
So, even if it was just going to be a small little thing. And so there was some dickering going on with the city and with the parks and recreation. And that kind of stalled Disneyland a little bit early in 53. And that's another reason why they were focusing on Zorro. But then Zorro stalled because the networks and the sponsors wanted Walt to do pilots. Mm-hmm. And Walt didn't want to do that. And they all, the three different networks, because they hadn't sold the project yet. And the three networks, all had different ideas. So each network wanted a different pilot. And Walt didn't even want to do one pilot. So about that time, about this same time, Bill Cottrell hired Dick Irvine out of 20th Century Fox to be the art director for Zorro, not for Disneyland. And they actually had collected some props and dressings for Zorro.
Oh.
They took over the old schoolhouse, if you will, that had been moved over from Hyperion and was sitting at the front of the lot. Mm-hmm. And so that's where this little WED operation was. It was just a three-person operation. They had taken a trip to Mexico, and they bought a whole bunch of stuff, a whole bunch of props and sets and wheelbarrows and donkey wagons and four-poster beds. And I guess that's how they furnished the office in the meantime. And all kind of concurrently together, basically Zorro was falling through. Yeah. And Disneyland was also kind of, struggling, but Walt wanted to shift the focus from Zorro over to Disneyland. And by this time he knew that they had to look for a different site for
it. Right.
So as soon as that decision was made, Dick Irvine hired Marvin Davis away from 20th Century Fox. So now it was a four-person operation. And this all was taking place in what, if you're familiar with the Walt Disney Studio, this little bungalow that they were in is now the studio store.
Oh, okay, yeah.
I don't think they know that. I've told one person that who works there.
Yeah.
And that's where Herbie would have done the, long weekend aerial.
Herb Ryman, for those of you.
Ryman. Yeah.
So that's how it got started. It was a weird kind of like 6 months. And you've heard the story probably of Welton Beckett telling Walt, you need to have your own guys do this. rather than have architects do it, the Disneyland.
Right.
So that's a sort of a true story, except that Walt didn't have his own people to do it because they had not done live action film. They were just getting started on 20,000 Leagues Under the Sea. And that would be the first live action picture shot on the studio lot. But that was being done mostly by Warner Brothers people, talent brought over from Warner Brothers, and other studios, and only committed for that one project. So Walt had to, you know, find his own. That's why they got Dick Irvine, and at first they kind of raided. They didn't raid because 20th Century Fox was laying people off. The writing was on the wall at all the motion picture studios that the art departments were going to be downsizing. So it wasn't like they stole any of these folks. They volunteered to go over to Disney. And so that's kind of how it got started. And there are three people that have said that they're the ones that told Walt that he had to get motion picture people. to do this park, and one of them was Pereira, and one of them was Charles Luckman, and one of them was Walton Beckett, and coincidentally all about this time they were all at a party at Art Linkletter's house. They were all friends, mutual friends, and so that's also where Pereira told Walt. It was Pereira probably who really told Walt this story, or they all told him this probably at this cocktail gathering. And you know, where they told him, you need to have your own, you know, motion picture people do this for you.
Yeah.
And so that's how the other thing that happened too that's really kind of funny is there was kind of a by the way letter written from Roy Disney to Pereira and Luckman, giving them an update on the talks with the city. This is early in 53. And he just kind of concludes this short little letter with, you know, kind of like a, by the way, we've just learned that the California, you know, Transportation Board is going to build a freeway right through the site in Burbank. A freeway. Yeah. And that was the moment, really, when that park across the street died.
Right. I can only imagine if it actually did happen, that would, I mean, it was so small.
Well, and yeah, it would have been interesting alternate history. Well, people think of the Walt, you know, they think of the Walt Disney Company today and just how massive it is and all these different things. But when you're going back to early 1950s, okay, you have, you know, Walt Disney Productions, which is a shareholder, you know, it's a publicly traded company at this point, right. Correct? And yes. And basically, if you looked at the paperwork, Roy O. Disney is like basically the head of the company. If you look at the paperwork,
he's the chairman of the board, I believe.
What does the company make? It makes animated movies and animated shorts.
And
that's basically what the company does, correct?
It makes a lot of money on consumer, you know, on toys and merchandise.
Licensing
books, comics, and they have offices, small offices all around the world.
And so Walt Disney has to form this separate entity. It just seems crazy now when any company, one of the first things they're going to think of is Walt Disney World or Disneyland or whatever. But Walt had to start this separate company. And as you said, now there's, maybe you can explain the relation. Okay, you mentioned WED, but of course, wasn't it going to be Walt Disney Incorporated at first, and then Roy was like, no, that's going to be that's too close to the name of Walt Disney Productions.
Yes, that's correct. It was Walt Disney Incorporated, and then Walt Disney Enterprises, or vice versa, and then it wasn't WED until I think the middle of 53, but it was the same entity. You know,
so
it wasn't
what is
like incorporated or anything. It was the same. It was the same legal entity, just changed its name.
And then what? So is the company Disneyland started later and separately from Wed?
Yes.
Okay. Yes.
So, and that, let's see, there's another thing that happens. I guess it's Walt Disney's contract finally gets figured out, also kind of in the middle of 53 or earlier in 53. And that's when certain agreements are made, you know, the name use agreements in exchange for the name Walt Disney. Walt Disney agrees to, you know, work for the studio and make that his prime focus. That's going to be a hard one to, you know, not breach. But also he agrees to not cannibalize the studio or tread on, you know, do any work on content that would compete with the studio. So that means no animation. And he hadn't really gotten quite yet into live action films, but it meant basically he could do TV and hire his own people to work on TV, but not hire people out of Walt Disney Productions to do that. And same with Disneyland. He could work on this Disneyland project, but at this point, they had just started 20,000 Leagues. They were in the middle of Lady and the Tramp. They were finishing up Peter Pan and getting ready to start on Sleeping Beauty. And all of these were very expensive projects and risky, particularly 20,000 Leagues, Lady and the Tramp, and Sleeping Beauty, which were expensive projects because they were involved with CinemaScope and new equipment and, you know, building a sound stage for the live action film. And so the studio, if one of those films flopped, it would have been serious. If two of them or three of them flopped, it would have been the end of the studio. So it was all hands on deck at the studio to get those projects going. And so Walt wasn't about to raid the studio at that point to staff Disneyland. And in fact, he doesn't really do that until Walt Disney Productions becomes a investor in Disneyland, a one-third partner in it. So, and even then, all those other projects were taking up the talent of John Hench and Claude Coates and Ken Anderson and all of those folks. So those guys don't end up coming into WED until like the middle or the end of 54. Mm-hmm. And until then, it's all new faces hired out of 20th Century Fox, MGM, and Warner Brothers to do Disneyland.
And when does Retlaw come into the picture?
64, I think. It might have been like finalized in 65. But
because they owned the rolling stock for the railroad, the monorails, and what they ended up with Walt Disney's name and likeness, correct?
The holding, let's see, the name use agreement and personal Disney family holding entity, part of WED, became Retlaw in 64.
Okay, because basically Disneyland is becoming a full, you know, Disneyland's on its way to becoming fully owned by Walt Disney Productions, right? They're buying out ABC, yeah, they're buying out, you know.
That happened in around 58.
Okay, yeah.
57 or 58, something like that, when they bought out ABC and I think Western Printing. And I was going to say, so if you worked on the trains in the 50s, you know, at Disneyland's opening, or even if you worked on the monorail when it opened, you worked for WED. That was what was on your paycheck, not Retlaw and not Disneyland, WED. Mm-hmm. And then that part of WED became Retlaw.
Yeah.
It's confusing.
Yeah, wow.
But that's how it went down.
Oh, interesting.
Yeah. So these very early days have really, you know, they've been touched on a little bit in some of the Walt Disney biographies and in some of the recent high-quality books, you know, like Todd Pierce has done, and Al Dallas and it, Leslie's book, Leslie Iwerks' book, gets a little bit into it, but it doesn't really go into, they don't really go into detail, and all of those books have slightly contradictory information to one another. So I finally wanted to get to the bottom of all of that.
Yes.
I just felt kind of an obligation. As long as I'm doing this book that was focused on the people, the first Imagineers, and where they worked out of and how they worked, I found myself, after reading all these different accounts, coming up with a timeline. And I think now, kind of, I hope it is the complete and final version of how WED started. Who, how, when, where, and all of that. It's, you know, not the most exciting part of the story, but I felt an obligation for someone to get it all collectively correct at some point.
I find that stuff interesting. I know some people might not, you know, but it's just an interesting when you think about today compared to back then. And just, you know, Disneyland opens up with, you have all these other companies running stores and restaurants, and you have contractors providing the security and the custodial and everything. And, you know, nowadays there's almost everything in the parks is completely controlled by the Walt Disney Company, which is what Walt Disney Productions became in the 80s. Right. You know, but it's just strange to think about. And that Imagineering is still there. I mean, it could have just, in 1984, I think one of the things that Michael Eisner and Frank Wells did right was that they did not dismiss all the park management when they came on board. A lot of times when you get new CEO, new chief operating officer, they're going to just bring in all their people from their previous positions, and they're going to get rid of, you know, the old timers that were there. They sure. kept the park management in place. You know, Dick Nunes,
yep,
Jack Lindquist, Ron Dominguez, those people. And they didn't shut down and spin off Imagineering. You know, they kept that in the company too, because they could have easily just said, no, we'll get, you know, all those people who work there can form their own little companies that will hire, or maybe, right. You know, and they didn't do that. They kept it.
It could have happened, you know, it could have happened a couple of times earlier too. I mean, it could have happened right after Disneyland opened. There was no obligation to keep that entity, or at least keep, you know, that group of people that were hired together in that way. I think most companies would have let that, you know, all of the staff go, and then hired up again when it was, you know, necessary. And also in 64, when that handover took place with Retlaw, was another opportunity, you know, where the company could have said, okay, we're gonna, you know, contract this all out.
Right.
Not likely to happen, you know, with Walt, but it could have. So, so there were a couple of times where it could have, you know, very easily been disbanded. And shortly after Disneyland opened, they, you know, there was a big layoff. It went from about 100 to 110 people down to about 40, I believe. But they were hired back up pretty quickly. A lot of the people that were laid off were brought back just a couple months later as they ramped up for Storybook Land and the Mine Train and the Skyway and all of those developments.
Yeah, I mean, everything that they – you go back to those early years. I was just reading Jim Corcus's book on historical highlights of those years, all the way up through 72. But, you know, it's right away, it's just – adding stuff, just constantly adding stuff. And then, of course, you know, the World's Fair, and then planning for Walt Disney World. So it was there was always something going on. Yeah. And I could see why Walt Disney kept it going.
Yeah. And, you know, they did eventually WED and Walt eventually came up with an agreement with the studio and with Disneyland, where they kind of shared or backfilled one another with the web talent. In other words, there was an office at Disneyland that was the engineering office that had a couple of architects and a few engineers. And so if there was some engineering, civil engineering or something like that, that needed to be done for upcoming attractions, then those people at Disneyland were put on the project first. And then WED would come in and do the show set designs and things like that. You know, the more showy and the more, you know, the architecture that you actually see in the park, but the groundwork for it, civil engineering and the engineering for it would be done at Disneyland by those drafts people, draftspersons. And same with the studio. So the studio after 20,000 Leagues was highly successful, they decided to do more live action films. That's actually the reason Harper Goff was brought over to the studio. Disneyland was one reason, but the main reason was Walt needed a really good, experienced live action film art director to get the art department started. Mm-hmm. And so Harper did that for 20,000 Leagues. And as soon as that film wrapped up, the eight or so people that he hired for 20,000 Leagues immediately jumped on to the Disneyland project. Then when the Disneyland project was finished in the summer of 55, some of those people went back and worked on the Great Train, or whatever it was called, the Locomotive Chase. Mm-hmm. Great Locomotive Chase and a couple of other films. So some of the people would go back and forth between Disneyland and film.
Amazing.
Yeah.
You had mentioned some of the early people that worked for WED that was part of the Disneyland project. When they finally got going on it and got into the major planning part, was it like hundreds of people were now part of WED, or was it just a smaller group? Or
no, it was much bigger than I had imagined, because somehow the impression, I don't think purposefully, but the impression that has been left with people who have heard the stories told by our, you know, founding fathers and mothers, that, you know, there, it was only, you know, it was just a handful of people, or 30 or 40 people. And that's true after Disneyland opened. It was true for a couple of months. But in fact, at the height of Disneyland, I don't know, I haven't done that particular count, like the peak count, right, the peak in-park count, but total people that were hired for WED to get Disneyland built was about 110. Those are people that would be working, reporting up to Dick Irvine, working out of the WED office at the studio. And not counting some of the outside contractors who, you know, had a major responsibility, like the Evans brothers, Bill Evans and Jack Evans. They were not employees of WED. They were outside contractors at the time. Same with Ruth Shellhorn,
right,
and a handful of others. So it was about 110 to design. How many people did it take to design Disneyland? About 110. And if you take into account the engineering, mm-hmm, which was all done outside, so there was one firm called Wheeler and Gray, and they did all of the structural. And I would say there was probably a dozen people off and on working on Disneyland from Wheeler and Gray. And then the J.S. Hamill Company did all the other engineering.
Okay.
Electrical, mechanical, civil, hydro, and that group was maybe about eight. Uh-huh. And yeah, so, you know, it's not like 1,000 people or 500 people. It was about 150 people to design and engineer Disneyland, and then you had outside firms that manufactured, mm-hmm, or produced thing. So I haven't done the count on that. But again, it's not 1,000. Yeah. It's, you know, 100 people involved maybe with that. You know, that's the building of boats and Atopia cars and things like that. Aero development up in Mountain View. So, you know, 500 people to design and build Disneyland.
Wow.
Well, okay, it doesn't take into account the construction. That's yet another entity. I don't even get into that.
But if
you're talking about like the WED function would be design, engineering, and manufacturing of the show elements and ride elements. And that would no more than 500 people for Disneyland.
Well, Disneyland in July, you know, July, August 1955 is, you know, quite smaller than Disneyland now. I mean, the stuff that wasn't there yet, you know, it was, it had a lot of room to grow.
Oh, yeah. But, I mean, there were things that you take for granted, like, you know, how to do all of that complicated landscaping, topographical earth movement on a sandy, you know, I think it used to be a riverbed and it was flooded out in 1938. So it was just the top 12 feet. Sometimes Bill Evans says it was 16. I don't know what it really was, but like at least the top 10 feet soil on that property was sand. And the only reason all the trees were living is because their tap roots went down about 24 feet into the ground. You know, you've got to amend that soil, and then you have to figure out how you're going to line all of the waterways and how are you going to build the berms? How, you know, how are you going to support the berms with a train track on it? It seems very elementary now, but it wasn't back then. In fact, even just doing a parking lot, no one had ever done a giant, you know, 100-acre parking lot that's just flat asphalt. So you go, well, how difficult could that be? But you have to take into account the drainage. If you don't drain it right, you're going to have cars hydroplaning and crashing into each other on a rainy day, like we've been having for the last 2 weeks. And the guy who had to figure that out, kind of the very fundamental things like that, like the parking lot, how to drain it, how to amend the soil, what kind of amendment do you put, or how do you line the rivers, or what do you line the rivers with? That guy is still alive.
Oh,
wow.
He's 94 years old.
And what was his name? What is his name?
Al Dorman. Al Dorman. And he later became the founding CEO of AECOM, which was at one time and maybe still is one of the 100 biggest companies in the world.
Wow.
Yeah. You were talking about the waterways. That always fascinated me. You know, Ken and I work there and get used to see the, when they do construction on certain parts of the moat or the, you know, in front of Adventureland by the Tiki Room, the waterways just, then I learned later, they're all, like a lot of them are connected together. It's really neat.
It is all connected. Yeah. It's all connected together. I may later do another book if I survive this one. This whole book project that I'm doing right now started as another project, and that was the archaeology of Disneyland.
Yeah.
And so I would still like to do that, and I have a lot of the material to do that, and I've learned a lot, you know, particularly about that water system and exactly where it went and where it was split up. You know, they had to have divergent pipes or conduits so that if they needed the moat to be dry, then they can't have the Jungle Cruise dry and the Rivers of America dry. So there were diversion pipes, basically. There were 14-inch concrete pipes. And they evolved over time, you know, when they took out that Phantom Boat Lake and then, you know, and the Matterhorn went in. And for some reason, it appears that when Monsanto went in, you know, there was a lake there before the Monsanto House of the Future was there. And that was part of the circulation system. But when they put the Monsanto house in, I think they isolated it. Because remember when it had that, like, awful Kool-Aid colored water in it?
Yeah.
I don't know why. I don't know why, but that did used to be part of the overall circulation system. So for some reason, that it was isolated.
Hmm.
Was the reason for connecting them all, was that just so the water doesn't stay stagnant and just...
Yeah, it was one of them. And also, it's more efficient. You know, you let gravity do the work versus, you know, getting two dozen different pumps, right. Circulation pumps. I mean, there were a lot of pumps, but they were able to, you know, you streamline it. There was kind of an economy of scale, I guess, by making it one consistent water system. And I found, I always like, okay, so where did the water come out? You know, they pumped it up from the rivers of America, but where did it come out?
Yeah.
On opening day, particularly before all of the storybook land, you know, the canal was there, but none of the scenes were in there or anything.
Mm-hmm.
So, I have all that information, and I found these very odd photographs taken by an outside photographer of, you used to be able to see the, what's the term they use for it? But basically where the water comes out, it was, you'd see it from the train. And there was a little stream that went in front of the train in Fantasyland. And they tried to make that kind of a feature, you know, with no money whatsoever.
Yeah.
But that was a little bit of a feature. You crossed a bridge to go to the Fantasyland train station over this little canal.
The headwaters of Disneyland.
That's exactly it, the headwaters. Oh, Thank you. You are. Yes.
Yeah.
So I don't know. Maybe I was a civil engineer in a past life or something, but I find all that earthwork kind of fascinating.
Yeah. Yeah.
The canals crack me up. The canal boats, you know, without anything to look at, you know.
Oh yeah, I know. It's funny that they just really hadn't had the time to even figure out what they were going to do with that. You know, the drawings for those little buildings weren't even done until after Disneyland opened. And I think that, you know, it was called Canal Boats of the World. So I think one of the selling points of it that they had in mind, but it didn't come out that way, was that each boat was going to be representative of the area, the international area that it was from. So they were going to have, you know, obviously Dutch canal boats, but there were English barge looking ones, and there were Chinese sampan looking ones. And so each boat was going to be different. And time and money, you know,
right.
Once again raised its ugly head. So they, you know, made, I think there may be two or three different styles of the boats, but they're generally the same. I think they kind of did mix and match parts. And I never knew that they were built in Newport. So all the time that I grew up in Newport, of course, that, you know, I didn't come along until after all that was done, but I didn't realize the amount of work that had been done in Newport Beach and Costa Mesa for the canal boats and the Jungle Cruise boats and the Autopia cars.
Wow.
So,
yeah.
Yeah, I find all that fascinating. I've heard you on a couple other podcasts and talking about the archaeology of Disneyland. I'm like, wow, that's so fascinating, because I always like to know, like, what was here in that place and this place. And we had the chance to kind of explore. We were in Custodial, and that, so we... You know, it's just kind of neat to see some of the back areas and different things.
I wish I could go back to that. You know, I remember when I worked there, and I went back there maybe once, you know, to say hi to someone. And, you know, I could barely even remember it. But was it behind the Mineral Hall? Was that where it was? Or was it behind the shooting gallery?
The Custodial
Office? The Custodial Office was right there. The Mineral Hall, I've mentioned this in several recent podcasts, the Mineral Hall facade over there at Casa Mexicana,
right.
if you would open the door, you were in the back of the Custodial Office. It was really weird because you have this really nice themed facade, And then if you opened it up, it was like this modern office environment with our schedulers were back there with their computers. And
right.
Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah. I like I said, I was there once to see a friend of mine who had a summer job as a custodian. And I remember also one time walking. Was it between the shooting gallery and Casa
de Cris? Yes, there was a doorway there that would take you backstage. Yeah.
Like once I did that. You know, I think of all the other places that, you know, I so many times would be backstage, but that one I didn't really explore too much. Now I know a lot about it now because I've been studying all the early plans. Mm-hmm. But
well, Tomorrowland's full of it. I mean, we would be backstage, maybe at like the Circle Vision building or whatever, and there was, you would see, like, you know, oh, this used to be the on stage wall right here. You know, you could see like PSA, logo and stuff like that.
Those columns, you know, those angled columns that were painted olive green, mm-hmm. That were exposed at Disneyland, you know, until '67. Those, I remember seeing those back there. Yeah. Behind and in fact, if you were to go on the People Mover, you would and with a flashlight, turn the flashlight on as you went into America the Beautiful. Those columns are still, you know, they're still there now.
Wow!
You'd see them if you went on. If you were an archaeologist and knew and look, but yeah, there's a lot of it in Tomorrowland because Tomorrowland's been, you know, mostly been built over versus bulldozed.
Yeah. Right.
Or at least a lot of it has been built over versus bulldozed. So, you know, yes. A lot of building columns and beams and everything are still there.
That's so neat. Well, before we go, I wanted to give you a chance to, you know, you said you're working on this book. Maybe plug it a little bit and talk about it.
Sure. Well, you know, it started off as the Archaeology of Disneyland, and then I kept discovering things about, I kept running across names I had never heard of before. And some of the names had been alluded to maybe by people that I had worked with, you know, it was like a first name or a last name kind of rang a bell. Mm-hmm. Or my boss, my first boss there, who was George Windrum, told me about a guy named Dean Tavolaris, who he worked with back in the 50s out of the WET office, who became a big production designer for Coppola, and it turned out all to be true, very true. So Dean Tavolaris, who's still alive also, has been nominated 5 times for an Academy Award and won for Godfather 2. He did all the Godfather films. He did every one of Coppola's films. And he was in the WET office for 8 years as a draftsman, started as an apprentice. So it was things like that, that like, okay, if it was just that, mm-hmm. or one other thing, but it was about, you know, 50 things. Like, oh my God, no one has, you know, I just couldn't believe it. I mean, I was told that there was no office, that there was not a WET office at the studio, mm-hmm. that everyone was just in their own office in their own different area, you know, mostly in the animation building, and the machine shop people were in another part of the, you know, campus, and the paint shop and all of that. Well, there was a WET office, and a very, you know, very specifically, I mentioned it. The first one was where the studio store is today. They were there for less than a year, I think, before they moved into a very specific wing of the animation building where they were until 1961. And then in 1961, you know, they moved to Glendale, and they didn't go to 1401 Flower Street. They went to 800 Sonora, where they were for about 4 years. And then they didn't move into 1401 until the summer of 65, which means that Walt really only was, you know, visited the 1401 building a year and 3 months, year and 4 months. And so most of the stories that you hear about Walt and Wed from kind of the classic group happened at the Sonora building, 800 Sonora. And today, if you talk to, you know, a lot of newer Imagineers, even older Imagineers, they think it's all started at 1401. And some might know that there was 800 Sonora before that, but virtually no one knows that for 8 years they were at the studio.
Wow.
And so that was the impetus for switching gears, because I thought, you know what, I've heard enough stories that some dots in this connect the dots mm-hmm. exercise are already there, and I've gathered material where there's other dots in place, and if I don't finish connecting the dots, there may not be anyone who can connect the dots
right
after that. So I felt obligated to switch gears and do this, and it's been really fun and fascinating, and I've found all sorts of photographs and interesting artifacts that we've never seen before. So if you think you've heard it all, seen it all, read it all, you haven't.
Right. Well, I'm excited. Yeah.
Disney, in general, is the gift that keeps on giving. I've seen enough now where it's like, wow, I can't even, you know, this one particular thing that I'm doing, which is very specific, which is the first 20 years, it's the first generation of Imagineering from 52 to 72, basically, mm-hmm. 71, they open up Walt Disney World, and there it stops. My piece of this stops because I consider that the first generation. Those are the first generation Imagineers.
Right.
And then the second generation Imagineers, of which I'm at the kind of tail end, someone in the third generation can write about the second generation. I'm in the second generation. I'm writing about the first generation.
Right, right.
and it's grown to be, it's going to be four volumes. Now, I always knew it would be like a big 400 or 500 page book.
Wow.
But as it started to get closer to 600, it was decided that it would be broken up into four volumes. And that way we can get a lot of, there's going to be no problem filling that. It's, editing
wow.
is the problem.
Right.
And
I'll start saving up my money now. I mean,
there's so many riddles and so many things that I'm not going to have time to track down. So, like I said, it's the gift that keeps on giving, because after these are published, there's still more information. There's more dots to connect. Mm-hmm. And there's a lot. There are more people living. They're in their 80s and their 90s that were there in the 50s, that were there in that original wet office.
Wow.
And I've just missed a few of them, unfortunately. If I had started this project 10 years earlier, it would have been fantastic. Mm-hmm. But there's at least a half a dozen people around from 55 who were there in 55. Mm-hmm. And then maybe another 10 people who were there, at the end of the 50s, into the early 60s, and more than that. I mean, it's probably 20, or so people. So, every day it's like, well, what do I do? Do I try to reach out to this person, or do I go treasure hunting? Because the treasures are not just at Disney. They're there at Disney, but they're also at universities where people donate their collections, when they pass away or whatever. If you're a real sleuth, you could go to one of these universities and you might find information that will tell you where every single orange tree on the Disneyland site was geolocated.
Wow.
It's located. So that you know over time, because they kept about 100, at least 100 orange trees in the park.
Mm-hmm.
And then they slowly, over time, disappeared. But if someone wanted to do that story, the information is there. In one of those university collections. Also photos, photo collections. Photos that you've never seen before are hiding in people's private collections. But the nice thing about the university collections is that you can use those in your studies or in your books, and you just need to give them attribution.
Very good. Is there, do you have a release date yet?
So volume one, I have submitted the first draft, and there's a book or two ahead of it. It's not being immediately published by Disney Editions. Disney Publishing and Editions has some coordination with it, and it's all being done with the approval of Disney Publishing and the Disney Company and all of the entities. But it's actually being published by Hyperion Historical Alliance.
Okay.
Yeah. So if you're familiar with that group, they've only printed two, but they've got a lot in the pipeline. You know, it was held up because of the pandemic.
Right.
And so there's going to be two or three really good ones coming out before mine. And so they think end of the year.
Great.
Cross fingers. Yeah. And then the subsequent volumes, of which I have a lot of material, we'll see. I might be able to get them pounded out every, on a 6 or 9 month interval afterwards.
Well, I'm excited about that. I'm a big book collector, and especially theme parks for Disney. So, yeah, I'm excited. Well,
you're gonna see two kinds of photos. You're gonna see photos you've never seen before, and you're gonna see photos that you've seen before and might even be sick of. But I'm going to give you more information about those photos.
Great.
About maybe where the photo was taken or who exactly. For example, you've seen the picture of Harper Goff and Walt Disney on a Jungle Cruise boat that's not quite completed. And there's a guy standing in the middle, kind of looks like Floyd the Plumber.
Yeah, yeah.
Got a cap on.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that Floyd the Plumber is a very important person. And I can't believe he's been overlooked all this time. And he should actually be a Disney, in my opinion, he should be a Disney legend. And I think he might be someday. And this is the engineer who did everything else. Not the one who's still alive. He hired the one who's still alive. But there was Wheeler and Gray. They did the structural. Then the guy who had the company that did all everything else was the J.S. Hamill Company. And the person standing in that photograph is J.S. Hamill, or Sam Hamill. Right. And he goes back to the 1939 World's Fair, where he did lighting and fountains for that fair. He was hired by Robert Moses. He was kind of a prodigy. He was a, you know, like a child prodigy engineering geek kind of guy. And so at a young age, he was designing fountains and lighting for the 39 World's Fair, and then did several big lighting and fountain projects on the West Coast and a few here in LA. And then he did Disneyland. And then when he was never done with Disneyland until he retired. So he was the go-to guy for all hydro lighting fountains. He's the one who helped Harper Goff figure out Schweitzer Falls and all of the, you know, the water issues on the Jungle Cruise and how to couple the Jungle Cruise boat to a track.
Mm-hmm.
All of that. He was an inventor, but his passion was water and lighting. And so then the 64 World's Fair comes around, and he again does all of the area development, lighting, and waterworks for the fair, including that big spectacular fountain of the what was it called? Fountain of the how quickly we forget, but the big one that synchronized fireworks, lighting, music, and water all together. It was the first, you know, World of Color show.
Oh, okay.
He did that. He also, his firm engineered the stretching rooms in the Haunted Mansion and all sorts of odds and ends. And he was so critical, so important to WED that Walt moved his office and built an office building for him on Buena Vista Street, one block up from the studio. Because he had to be like a five minute walk away.
Oh, wow.
Because he was so important to all of the projects they were doing.
Right.
and that office is still there. I think the building is now part of the Disney, part of the Disney studio operation. But it's this kind of, all of a sudden there's this mid-century modern building on Buena Vista up on the next block up. And that was where this guy Hamill and Harper Goff, this is a story that I want to, everything in this book, I want to like absolutely make sure it's true.
Yeah.
You know, I'm not just taking, I think part of the problem over time is the story has been told by, you know, secondhand, third hand, fourth hand. And I want to find the absolute, you know, genesis of the story. But both Hamill and Harper Goff claim that they, in partnership, designed the Unisphere for the World's Fair. And that is somewhat controversial because the Unisphere was to be designed by a New York firm by contract and agreement. And it was on paper, but apparently it was really designed by Harper and Hamill. Hamill could do it because he was the, you know, even though he was a California company, he was involved with, you know, so much of the area development, anything water and lighting he was involved with. And so probably had to do some of the drawings, but apparently Harper really designed that and some other company basically did, you know, the construction drawings for it. Mm-hmm. And, that's a story I'm chasing down right now.
Wow. There's just so much and I'm excited about all that. Tom, thank you. I know we could keep talking all night. I love talking Disneyland, but, we'll have to continue this another time, but thank you so much for your time.
Sure. Yeah. Always happy to.
Yes. Thank you. Thank you. This was fascinating.
Okay. What an episode. What a discussion we had with Tom.
Yeah. I mean, I know I say it a lot, but I really could. I could listen to him go on and on and on.
Yeah.
And we'll definitely have to have him back. You know, this is stuff that gets glossed over or lost, or, you know, if someone doesn't bother to research this stuff, it just goes unpublished. And it's great that he's putting this stuff all together. And if you ever follow him on Twitter, you can see some of the stuff, you know, and some of the locations that he talks about. It's amazing.
Yeah, I'm really excited about his books coming out later this year. Well, before we leave, I wanted to read. We have a review. I always say that I will read the reviews if you leave one on Apple Podcasts, whatever it's called here. I use my phone, so it has the Apple app for podcasts on there. But I think iTunes is on the the PC or Mac. You know, the computer version is iTunes. So I'm going to read this here. This is from December 29th, and it's titled Great Podcast, 5 Stars.
Oh.
From Danny J795. It says, I have been listening to the Sweet Spot podcast for years, and I really love it. I love hearing about the history of the park and all of the guest interviews with former cast. It is truly a great podcast.
Wow.
Yes. Thank you so much. Really appreciate
it. Very, very nice.
Yeah, so let's keep those coming because that really helps people find us. And I really want people to find us because I think some of these interviews, like people like Tom, if you're into Disneyland history, I just think it needs to be shared more. I think people really will enjoy those. So leave a review. And if you've been listening to the show for more than one episode and you like it, go on to Apple Podcast and leave a review, and I'll read it on our next episode.
And check out our website, thesweepspot.com, for all the information about our books, t-shirts, you know, all the stuff that is revolved around this podcast.
Right. Well, thank you so much for listening, and we'll talk with you next time.